The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
I kind of see this as a part two to last week. It wouldn't leave me. Last week, I covered how to become a spiritual expression. And I touched lightly on the boundaries in the spirit. So I'm going to call this kind of part two, but it's spiritual boundaries. How many have had teaching on boundaries? I've even taken bits and pieces out of, who's that, Townsend and Cloud. And they had a book on, of course, I tweak it to my own use, but there's some valid principles that are universal. And when we traveled church to church, I think God helped me see some patterns that was in the church universal. When you're in one church, you see what's going on in your church, but when you travel church to church, you see patterns. Patterns and strengths and weaknesses, both. And the four elements that I saw, and this is kind of a preface before I get into spiritual boundaries, and we're going to talk about boundaries, because I saw that there was a need for adjudication. That means to enforce the rule of the conquering King Jesus. Do you believe that? That Jesus is Lord, and that we're responsible to enforce that rule, and we're under his rule, and enforcing that rule means that we're allowing him to rule in our life. That means basically to enforce that rule. We're seated together with him in the heavenly places. We should adjudicate. So here's four words. I'm going to give you more than you can handle, so I strongly suggest you take notes or get the CD or watch it again on Ustream, because I'm going to overload you today, but in a good way, because I'm looking for that to preach actually means to thrust, like with a sword. And so it's that one part that pierces you that could make all the difference in your life. So there'll be a lot of content, but look for the thrust. Look for that part that enters in. So adjudication is basically bringing to the church to enforce that rule of the conquering king. And when peace rules, God rules, and that kingdom will expand. You also need to know, besides adjudication or how to rule in the place of spiritual authority, but you need to understand your territory, your jurisdiction. You need to know, what is the assignment God has given me? What is my mission? What is the family mission? What is the corporate? Becoming part of something bigger than yourself. But nonetheless, you still need to know how to adjudicate, how to rule in your realm, how to know what your realm is, jurisdiction. Third, that the spiritual principle in the kingdom is displacement, that God comes in, occupies and displaces the negative powers, and that includes the world, the flesh, and the devil, anything that's in the way. And lastly, that we have to learn to contend in order to progress or advance. So it was adjudication, jurisdiction, displacement, and advancement. And in those four words, I saw needs in the body at large. Adjudication, I saw, instead of adjudication, I saw abdication. I heard testimony after testimony of people throwing the word, God told me, God told me. I'll tell you what, it gets to the place where it's hard to trust it after a while, God told you. It's a lot of it. God told me to, bless God, he gave me this job. And a week later, God told me to quit that job. That's abdication, that's not adjudication. If God gives you an assignment and a place of mission, he gives you the anointing to sustain you there, not only sustain, but even to overcome, and to be an influence for good, even in a stinky old job. So be careful before you say, God said, and he doesn't change his mind quickly. He doesn't send you to a job and then 1 week later tell you, thus saith the Lord, quit thy job. All right. People do that, but God doesn't act like them. The third level is displacement, that when you go to that job and you know the mission and the assignment, God basically gives you the anointing to basically be a godly influence in that environment, no matter how evil that environment is. Greater is he that is in you than he that's in the world was meant to be a reality, not just theory. And lastly, advancement. I believe that what God is going to raise up in this day and age from the church, or the priesthood of the believer in the church, the day of the saints, when the priesthood of the believer comes up and is more responsible in self-governance, you're going to see them contending and to learn war. I believe that peacemakers are those who first know how to conquer the world, the flesh, and the devil. All right? So having said all of that, that's actually kind of a review. I want to cover boundaries today. Spiritual boundaries, all boundaries, natural or spiritual, are spiritual, because ultimately Jesus is going to rule for believers. So there are laws and principles that are in nature, but they're also in the spirit realm as well. There's boundaries that need to be broken. Point one for people to take a note. Boundaries that need to be broken, and that's the world, the flesh, and the devil, and any hold that they have on you, those boundaries need broken. There are boundaries that need to be advanced. For the kingdom of God suffers violence, and the violence take it by force. Basically, you need to expand the rule of God, that the kingdom of God, the Prince of Peace, of his kingdom, there's no end, and that kingdom is going to continue to expand to the degree on earth as it is in heaven, that you take that peace into your realm. You are expanding that boundary. You're expanding your influence, and God wants you to expand that influence. Then there are boundaries that need to be established. And when we talk about the ministry of reconciliation, we need to understand boundaries. And that's really what I want to get into today, because these boundaries that need to be established need to be understood, that there are some boundaries that need to be maintained and sustained. And it's for the purposes of God. So some need to be broken down and removed, others need to be expanded, and others need to be sustained and maintained. And there's laws of relationship. And we taught this in a BEH class once. This is behavior problematic children who the teachers couldn't handle, so they lumped them all in one room and gave them to Jennifer. And she went, OMG, what do I do now? All right, I have all of these behavior problems that the teachers couldn't handle, and they threw them all in one room. And Jennifer basically talked about the invisible laws of principles, and you don't have to believe in them, you don't have to like them, but they're going to work. Boy, that get their attention. Something is going to work whether you like it or not and whether you believe it or not. And these laws of relationship, the first one and the big one is the law of sowing and reaping. It works whether you believe in it or not. Walk off a cliff, you don't have to believe in gravity, but you're going to fall. That law is going to operate whether you believe in it or not. The second one, and this is important, is you sow to the wind, you reap the whirlwind. There is a law of increase. And this taught me not to have long temper tantrums, because I was always thinking that I was basically expressing myself to God on how much I didn't like a particular situation. But what he showed me was the law of increase, that you sow a seed, you reap a harvest. So the longer you sow that negative seed, it is building momentum. I didn't care for that, because that meant it would be more powerful in your life in an adverse way. So I found out the temper tantrums had to go quicker. What used to devastate me for a week started to bother me for a day or two. I used to call in work and say, I didn't want to lie, but I would say, I'm sick. And then I'd hang up and say, and tired. And I'd stay in bed basically because I was bummed out, to be honest. Sick and tired. I thought I was telling the truth. Oh, we play games. It's just like, I know that God knew better, but I didn't. So there's, in the law of relationship, there's sowing and reaping, and that works whether we believe in it or not. There's the law of the principle of increase, and that's true for sanctification as well. When you sow to the Spirit, you reap from the Spirit, and you reap life, and you reap strength and substance, that fruit that remains, and nobody can take it away. The third law of relationship is, if you judge, you will be judged by the same measure. And also in that judgment is, you who judge, you will do the same thing. You should have seen the teenagers and in middle school that objected to that concept. No, this is a law. The very things that you hate in your mom or dad, you will do the same thing. You can say, I'm not going to do that. Oh, yes, you will, because that law works whether you believe in it or not. It's the law of sowing and reaping. Be not deceived. God's not mocked. What you sow, you reap. And so you can't change that except through repentance and forgiveness. It's the only thing that can stop that reaping. So judge not, lest you be judged, but you who judge, you will do the same thing. You might be clever and do it a different way, but you will end up doing the same thing. And lastly, honor your mother and father. It's the law of relationship, that life might go well. Conversely, to the degree you do not honor mother and father, things do not go well. And you don't have to like it. And when you say honor your mother and father, we're not talking about honoring their bad behavior. We're talking about honoring God and His Word. And His Word says, forgive them. When you truly forgive them and there's a supernatural exchange in your forgiveness, then you have the capacity to do differently. But as long as you stay mad, you cannot do differently. You who judge, you will do the same thing. All right? This is my preface to spiritual boundaries. That'd be enough right there to have an altar call. All right? But here's the concept that I believe is that bitter roots. How many know? I think we should do a whole series on bitter roots because we cover that in module 2, but we don't cover it that much. But it's basically pursue peace with all men and sanctification without no one, without which no one will see the Lord. So no one comes short of the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springs up and causes trouble, and by it many are defiled. And basically, pursue peace with all men, because beware lest a bitter root spring up, and listen to this, it will cause you trouble and defile others. How many know that abused children have a tendency to grow up and be somewhat abusive? Because to the degree that it troubles you, you will actually push people, even though they're responsible for their own sin, you will push people to sin against you. A bitter root springs up, causes you trouble, and defiles other people. How does it defile them? It will push them to sin against you. Are they responsible for their own sin? Of course they are. But who wants to know that the offense is coming by my pushing them? All right? So in all of this laws of relationship, these laws have been placed in the natural realm and the spiritual realm. I think it would be wise for us to cooperate in the plans and the purposes so that life goes well with us. Because conversely, to the degree we don't cooperate with these laws, life does not go well with us. And very often, we get caught up in the blame game, and in reality, it's not the other person's fault. It's how we respond to their faults. All right, here's some boundaries that need to be established. They're not taught about in the church very often, and they probably need to be brought up. And that is divisions. 1 Corinthians 5, verse 11 says, but now I have written to you not to keep company with anyone named a brother who is sexually immoral or covetous or an idolater or a reviler or a drunkard or an extortioner, not even to eat with such a person. See, some people say, that doesn't sound loving. But this is a scriptural mandate that love has to make and establish holy boundaries. And there's times when you need for their good to allow them to have a consequence. When you remove consequences from people, you are not loving them. And therein lies a major problem when we talk about boundaries. All right? Now, in giving these instructions, I do not praise you, since you come together not for the better, but for the worse. First of all, when you come together as a church, I hear there are divisions among you, and in part I believe it, for there must also be factions among you, that those who are approved might be made recognized among you. In reality, when there are problems in the church and there are factions and schisms, the only good thing that can come out of that, because that's not a good thing, but the only good thing that come out of it is those that are approved are made manifest. Hard times show you who's with you. It's like the Russian soldiers that went in with machine guns to a bunch of Christian worshipers, and they said, renounce Jesus. And two-thirds of them renounced Jesus and left, and got left with their life. The other ones, the soldiers came, put their weapons down, and said, these are the people we want to worship with, the ones that wouldn't renounce Jesus. And so, divisions must come, that those who are true are made manifest. Now, It also says, they went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest, that none of them were of us. This is kind of like simple, isn't it? It's kind of like you can tell who's with you and who's not with you. Because it's basically long-term relationship that God is interested in, not short-term relationships. That's almost like an opportunist. And sometimes people with a business mind sometimes get caught up in that in the church, and they function more as an opportunist than they function as a brother or a sister looking for relationship. Because all true blessing flows out of destiny. Destiny always includes people, but people are not to be used as a means to an end. And we're going to get to that a little later. We shared in part one, I call it part one, how to become a spiritual expression, how understanding revelation has its own boundaries. Everybody that prophesies out there is not a prophet, trust me. And some of them hide their deficiencies behind the prophetic. Like, well, you might think I'm wacky, I'm just prophetic. No, you probably could be wacky, right? That's a nice cover for it, though. But your level of revelation will be directly proportional to how much spiritual influence you have. I'm not talking titles here. I'm talking influence with God. That's what God cares about. How much influence with God you have. And basically, Matthew 16, he said that to Peter. He said, who do you say that I am? That will determine how much influence. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. He said, flesh and blood didn't teach you that, but my Father in heaven revealed to you. You have spiritual authority, and I'm going to base on that revelation, I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So your level of revelation will determine how much spiritual influence you have. Not how much you know in your head, how much revelation you have. Secondly, your second level of revelation is according to your ability to hear. He who has ears, let him hear what the Spirit says. We all have a capacity. Psalm 40, verse 6 even says in the Amplified, I don't want your sacrifices. That's religion. I have given you a capacity to hear and obey. That's what's pleasing to God. So that means I've given you all a capacity. It's what you did with that capacity. And like Mark chapter 4, the hearing heart, I call it. The hearing heart is the soils. It depends how the word penetrates that hearing heart or not, 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. It depends on what is in the heart and how you receive. And various levels will determine your level of revelation. It will be equal to your ability to hear. Your level of revelation will equal your gifts and your callings. All can prophesy. Not all are prophets. Your revelation will be limited by the boundary of that particular gifting or calling. It's interesting, when an evangelist reads scripture, it's always to win souls. When an apostle reads scripture, he's always trying to build, all right? When a prophet, he's always pointing to thus saith the Lord, all right? There's an ability within the realm of your gifts and your callings to get particular specific revelation within a boundary of that calling and that gifting. Your level of revelation will equal the size of your heart. I liken this unto Jabez, who said, enlarge my territory, but he also said that I would not cause pain. So what he's basically saying, enlarge my territory, but make sure my heart's big enough to match that territory, that I don't cause pain, that I have a redemptive heart in the midst of the territory that's been increased and enlarged. Make sure I have an enlarged heart, in other words. All right? Now, there's four authority structures. Before we get into boundaries and before we understand the rules, we have to understand that whether you've got problems with these authorities or not is not the issue. The fact is, it's got God placed them. And when he placed them, there are certain laws and principles that are going to operate whether we like them or not. All right? You might not like your boss, but God's never going to do away with authority. The four realms of authority that we need to understand, jurisdiction and adjudication and all of those other good things, is first of all, in the home. In the home, it's a realm. Honor your mother and father that things may go well with you, Deuteronomy 5. Doesn't that make sense though? Honor them doesn't mean honor their bad behavior. Honor them by forgiving them, which honors God. Actually, we've been all called to the ministry of reconciliation. That brings up a point. This has been kind of a burr in my saddle. I'm seeing people try to do this forced reconciliation, and they're calling it reconciliation. I'm seeing people saying the grandfather molested every child in the family, and then the family is insisting that in the name of love that we let them babysit. Really? God is love, but love isn't God. Don't make it like that, because it will never move. There's time for established boundaries to be in place and sustained. That is love. Matter of fact, legal love is to put someone in prison to protect others from harm. There has to be an understanding of jurisdiction. There has to be an understanding of consequence. There has to be an understanding that in the home, there is a jurisdiction. And nobody has better revelation for that home than a godly man or woman in that home. No one outside of that home has greater authority. In the church, let the elders who rule be counted worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in the word and doctrine. That's church. Government. I exhort you, first of all, with supplications, prayers, and intercession, giving thanks made for kings and all who are in authority, that we might lead a quiet and peaceful life in godliness and reverence. In business, be obedient to those that are your masters, to the flesh, with fear and trembling. In sincerity of heart, do it as unto the Lord. If we were to do everything in all of these authority structures as unto God and not unto people, the attitude would probably self-correct to a large degree. In other words, Jesus is your king. He's your boss. He's your father. You know, you could go right down the four authority structures, and if your life was really devoted to him, you would probably adjust quite well in all four realms of authority. I just had a politician call a state representative called me, and he thanked me because I guess during the elections it got brutal. And they were supposed to be Christians on both sides. And the things that were said and done were not very godly, and it hurt him deeply. And when he called me, he was going to justify it, and I basically, not justify it, but he was hurting. And now he called recently and said, I'm glad that you nailed me on that and told me how to respond properly. And in some cases, people that you've respected in years past, you may have to set up and sustain a boundary. Just because they have a title reverend in front of their name doesn't make them a Christian. No more than standing in a garage makes you a car. All right? And he's honored them and truly forgave them, but in reality does not have to welcome them into certain arenas or jurisdictions. Okay? So that's true of home, church, government, and business. Now, having said that, that's probably a lot, all right? Anything ministering to you yet? No? Okay. All right, here we go. I want to start with the laws governing boundaries. And this is my interpretation of some of the things that that Townsend and Cloud state in their book. It's a good book to get if you want. I have to tweak it only because of the way I think. I think differently in some of those terms, especially with self-initiative. I think it's God initiative. It has to be God initiative. But law number one is the law of sowing and reaping. And if you're a note taker, just write this down next to it and this will help. The law of sowing and reaping is basically the law of cause and effect. And our actions have consequences. If you just went that far, our actions have consequences, cause and effect. That is a spiritual law. That is a natural law. Do not be deceived. God's not mocked. What a man sows, they will also reap. You can't avoid consequences. In simple English, if you overspend, more than likely down the road, you're going to be in debt. If you eat right and exercise, down the road, you will probably have better health. These are just laws of cause and effect. And the first law is that in human relationships, and this is what I'm concerned about, because for me, it's people. The kingdom of God is people. God's mission and assignment is people. And the problem that I see in relationships is this lack of understanding boundaries and calling it love in many cases. And that's where the problem is. For example, if every time you overspent, your mom stepped in and covered you, she would be keeping you from experiencing the consequence. They would call that love. But in reality, they're overriding a boundary of cause and effect. And they're basically taking away your ability to suffer the consequence and learn from it. It's not about suffering. It's about learning from it, making mistakes, but learning from them. And you'd never learn anything. You'd do it over and over again. Why wouldn't you do it over and over again if someone else covered for you every time? You'd say, that's a good deal. You would call it a good deal. That's where I say that's an opportunist. Opportunists are people who know how to tap in. They might have good business sense, but in reality, in the kingdom, there's certain business principles you shouldn't be using in the kingdom. Don't be always looking for what's a good deal and compromise your value system for a good deal. I've seen hirelings in the church to where they couldn't possibly serve out of love. They had to say, what is in it for me? What do I get out of it? All right? And God makes a distinction in those attitudes of the heart. So law number one is the law of sowing and reaping, and that's the big granddaddy law. Matter of fact, Jesus himself said, if you don't understand this, how will you understand any of the parables? Because this is an all-encompassing law of reciprocity. As you sow, you will reap. And there's no wiggle room here except repentance and forgiveness. It's the only thing that can stop negative reaping. It's the only thing. So that's law number one. And in that law number one, most people have a tendency to step in when it's not wise to do so. Do you believe that? Most of the time, to violate the law of sowing and reaping, most of the time, in the name of love, people have a tendency to step in when it's not wise. If you keep mowing the lard, if you keep mowing that too, yeah, you keep mowing the yard for your son or your daughter, basically they grow up and they never learn to take responsibility for themselves. Sometimes people have and this I see as a pastor all the time, and it looks like ministry, but it's not ministry. They have a savior complex or a rescuer. They want to rescue. They really don't care so much about the person as much as they have a need to be needed. Say amen to that. They have a need to be needed. It's still selfish. I have a need to feel important. I have a need to feel needed. So I have a savior mentality when they feel like they want to save those they love from being hurt. Listen to me. We've given you the God tools to show you how to properly deal with pain in your life. But when you try to save other people from pain, you are doing them a great injustice. Teach them what to do with their pain. Teach them how they present it to Christ, and he takes our pain and our sorrow. You're not a savior, and you're not Jesus, and you're not saving somebody by pain by running in there and sticking your 2 cents in. You're violating other people's boundaries. There are more people who think they are doing good when they're really being busybodies and getting into somebody else's jurisdiction. If we don't understand boundaries and jurisdiction, you won't even be hearing from God correctly. Because you're trying to fix the fix that God put them in to get them to the place where they will change. Now, here's the other thing that I saw. Not only do they go to great lengths to fix something or someone else, but by doing that, they only drain themselves. Some of the most worn out people I met in the body were serving other people. There's something wrong with your serving if you're worn out serving. You're probably violating their boundary, and you're probably doing for them something that they should be doing for themselves. Think about it. You shouldn't be worn out loving people. If you're worn out loving people, you're probably trying to save them from pain or do something for them that they should be doing for themselves. What you're doing, and this will have a consequence, moms, dads, with your children, you're taking power away from them, and someday they're going to love power. If they don't remedy that in Christ, you're taking power from them. They don't feel like they have a say. They don't feel like you've stripped them of all rights of self-dignity, and you are rescuing them constantly. You're doing for them constantly. You keep them from experiencing the consequences and learning from them. It's basically called codependence, is what they would call that, codependent. But this is this so-called codependence in some relationships where one partner attempts to rescue the other from the pain naturally occurring from the choices they made. You're rescuing them from the pain, from the choices they made. You didn't make them, they made them. You are not rescuing or saving anybody. I used to call it, when I was a young pastor, actually it was before I was pastoring, I had home groups and little groups. I saw it as, I used to call it the Florence Nightingale syndrome. I think, don't be offended now, I think some people, even before they're sanctified and saved and know better, I think some go into certain fields and certain professions out of the need to be needed. I think there's certain philanthropy that is basically people give, but they don't care about the people. It's to relieve the guilt in their own heart. Do you see how we need to understand motive if you're going to understand boundaries? God is love. Love is not God when it's at the expense of violating somebody's boundary or righteousness. Okay? In some relationships where the partner attempts to rescue the other one from that pain, in those relationships, they never really grow. They assume that whenever they messed up, my partner will take care of it. My partner will fix it. Husbands and wives, they won't grow. And that is not loving them. That's a hard truth, isn't it? Because we just like to say, I'm loving them. No, that's not loving them. They're not going to grow. They assume that whenever I mess up, my partner will step in and save them. And it's usually in an emotional sense. I want to say, if you would learn that I was bought with the price, I'm not my own, and my emotions belong to God. Nobody can think for me, nobody can choose for me, and nobody can feel for me. I have a responsibility for those three to be under the Lordship of Jesus, not under someone else. That's just law number one. Are you ready for the rest of these laws? Law number two. The law of responsibility. We traveled church to church. We even printed out cards for this verse of scripture because this is so prevalent. Ownership versus responsibility or stewardship. You don't own your children, but you're responsible. The law of responsibility says they are God's servants, not mine. Ooh. They belong to Him, not to me. God is able to tell them whether they're right or wrong, and God is able to make them do as they should. Now, you have a law to fulfill your responsibility as a parent to raise them in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord, but to the degree that they do not respond, you need to release them into the loving, capable hands of God, because you cannot have dominion or control over another person. When God created us in His image to have dominion on earth, it was dominion over everything but people. Over every creepy thing, well, some of them are kind of creepy, but every creepy thing that creeps along the earth, you're to have dominion over. And the fish of the sea, but not people. We are responsible to each other. Listen to this. If you're a note taker for law number two, the law of responsibility, write this down. We are responsible to each other, but not for each other. That will keep you safer. We are responsible to each other. That's the love commandment. We are responsible to each other, but we are not responsible for each other. You're responsible for yourself. This is going to go against the grain of an entitlement generation. They like the nanny state as a better concept. Let the government take care of me. I don't know. There's a hurricane coming in Florida. Where's my water? Where's my thing? You know, in the old days, you used to go to the store and get your water. If a hurricane was coming. Duh. This is not complicated. It's not rocket science. All right? So law number two of responsibility, we are to love one another but not be one another. I can't feel your feelings for you. I can't think for you, and I can't make choices for you. Well, actually, I can't behave for you. Is that what we try to do? And I can't work through the disappointments that limitations bring for you. These are all the things that between you and the Lord are supposed to work out for yourself. You are responsible for yourself. I'm responsible for myself. We are responsible to people, but not for people. In reality, they are responsible for their own feelings, and ultimately, I'm responsible for mine. Law of responsibility. Got it? Next law. The law of power. Pay attention to this one. We do have power over some things. We don't have power over others, including, everyone will just go right over your head, including changing other people. That is a power problem in you when you're going to change someone else. Do you realize that? And you're violating a boundary, and in your attempt to change that other person, you're probably pushing them. And they're going to react to that push, and they're going to either push back or run away. Or they're going to lay down, be a doormat, and then they're going to hate themselves for it. God said, let us make man in our image. Let him be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, and have dominion over the fish, the sea, the birds, every living thing that moves on the earth. And here, in light of understanding power, is that he who is slow to anger is better than the mighty. He who rules his spirit than he who takes a city. So you can be a mighty general like Mark Antony, and yet he had lust problems. So he was a great general, could take a city, but a pretty woman could throw him and jeopardize the safety of his own men. Spiritual maturity and emotional maturity. Spiritual maturity demands emotional maturity. It demands it. And so those emotions belong to God. You're not your own. You were bought with a price. No more living in denial and ignoring those emotions. People have been taught to just ignore them. Men would say, I don't have emotions. You don't have any good ones. Don't tell me you don't have emotions. I see what's on the road. I see the reaction. There's a lot of frustration and anger out there. Don't tell me you don't have any emotions. Say you don't have any good ones. I can buy that. Because you suppress them and you stuff it. But that can make you a time bomb that's going to explode. The law of power. Basically, we've learned that the quickest way to bring healthy results to a spiritual son or daughter is that emocognition, emovolition. The emotions rule the thoughts and the emotions rule the choices. You don't deal with those emotions. Good luck with your thoughts and good luck with your choices. Because Romans 7 says, the things I want to do, I don't do. The things I don't want to do, those things I do. There is a source in that affects your emotion either positively or negatively. It's either going to be the fruit of the spirit for the believer, or it's going to be some toxic emotion that's going to decide for you. And understanding boundaries, we've got to understand this power thing. There is a state of powerlessness, a state that many know very well, and they have to fight against it every day. How many have ever felt powerless? But that's a fear motive. We taught it as the fear of the unknown, the fear of the unattainable, and the fear of the uncontrollable. If you live in that fear, you're going to be in there looking for a power struggle. You're going to try to fix all those things. But in reality, a more implicit trust in God, that peace would expand your dominion and your spiritual influence regardless of whether you think it's attainable, regardless if you think it's controllable. You're not supposed to be controlling it anyway. And regardless if you think that, unattainable, uncontrollable, unknowable. I don't have an answer. But you know what I found out? I'd say, God, how are you going to get me out of this mess? I felt like an old Laurel and Hardy movie where the two partners, two comedians, one always says, that's a fine mess you got me into this time, Ollie. He was always picking on his partner that it was always his fault. But I would just say it to God. I don't have the answer. This is beyond my knowing. How are you going to get me out of this one, God? And you know what? He'll find a way where there was no way, and that wisdom will find a way. When you will trust with a more implicit trust, there is an open door for wisdom of application, the wisdom that comes from above. But this state of powerlessness needs to be understood. maybe I'll get into it a little later on. But anyway, what we're training people to do in understanding power is that we use from the Message, 2 Corinthians 10, verses 5 and 6. For we use our powerful God tools for smashing warped philosophies, tearing down barriers that have been erected against the truth, fitting every loose thought, emotion, and impulse, that's your will, into a structure of a life shaped by God. And our tools are ready and at hand for clearing the ground of every obstruction. What does that tell you? It tells me you really don't have an excuse, that you have within you, in Jesus, you have the God tools to remedy all of these things, to bring every loose thought, emotion, and impulse into a life controlled or structured by Christ. Personal responsibility, self-governance, again and again and again. We're going to break that paradigm of entitlement when we're going to basically see that God is causing us to enter into the spiritual blessing that He has for each and every one of us in the heavenly places. They're available. We are a partaker of that. But law number four, the law of respect. When God taught me to pray and took me into the school of prayer, He called it, for me, it was the law of honor. But honor, respect, it's basically, Dennis, every time you close your eyes, you honor me. There's no better place to start. It doesn't matter whether you get a revelation. Doesn't matter whether you see getting all this wonderful material. It's basically, when you close your eyes, the attitude that's being projected from your heart is you're honoring me and respecting me, and you're putting me first place. It says, if we wish for others to respect our boundaries, we've got to learn to respect theirs. I thank God that I really believe it started when my mom took me as a 5 or 6 year old, and she'd have me sit down in a chair and she'd explain to me boundaries. If you haven't received that, I think you're shortchanged. But what she did was, we were in a suburb of South Chicago, and our neighbors had just moved from inner city, never had grass, never had a yard, never knew what it was like. And my mom would say, you see the way they strung the little string around their little yard, which was not even as big as this room? You see the way they, it's because they never had a yard. So if when you kids play ball, you play on our yard. You don't play on theirs. Just because it's okay to play on yours doesn't mean you automatically go there. And she said, you notice the way the Hanson kids, there was a million of them. She says, they all just, all the friends and neighbors just walk right in. She says, you don't do that, you knock. Those little things like that stick. And I found out that, you know when we should have learned these things? Probably around ages 4, 5, and 6. We really should have learned these things. Because it's really just common sense. Boundaries is common sense. Boundaries is the law of respect and honor for other people's things. So this law of respect, it says in the church, give double honor to those who labor in word and doctrine. Let each of you love his own wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects or honors her husband. There's nothing that gives me more red flags than when a wife talks ugly about her husband. I see that there's a need for tremendous work there. If that should be the last person you uncover, right? It's different. And people say, well, when is it gossip and when is it counseling? If you're part of the problem and part of the solution, it's not gossip, but otherwise it is. The law of respect. Actually, to seek first the kingdom of God is the law of respect, isn't it? And all these things will be added unto you, including proper relationships. If we want people to respect our boundaries, we must respect theirs at all. Freedom begets freedom. Now, when we accept the others, we have the right to set boundaries with us. We feel better about setting our own. When we accept that others have the right to setting boundaries, we feel better about setting our own. Now we're going to get into the nitty-gritty, and this is the place where it gets a little problematic. I believe that the first thing an individual needs to learn is to integrity. Let your yes be yes and your no be no. Everything else is of the evil one. Do you know people say yes and no for all the wrong reasons? Rather than going by your value system, they're going by an emotion of fear of what other people will think. You establish boundaries that are healthy because then it declares who you are and what you believe. When you don't declare your boundaries clearly, then They may not like those boundaries. How many have ever raised teenagers? Sometimes they don't like the boundaries. They think you hate them and you're punishing them. No, it's for your safety that things might go well with you down the road, because you know what? I'm your parent and I'm in this for the long haul. You're here looking for immediate satisfaction and relief. You want out. You have an escapism right now. But I'm looking at the long term. I'm looking for someday you're going to be a mother and someday you're going to raise children. And in that concept, these are the boundaries I've established for your good, that things would go well with you. Now, in this law of respect, yes be yes, no be no. For whatever is more than these is from the evil one. And if your brother sins against you, go to him and him alone. The church still doesn't do that. And here, what do they say? I love this. This is the excuse of all excuses. If you have aught, go to that person and that person alone. And you know what they'll say? They'd rather gossip, but they'll say, I'm afraid to tell them. That's an excuse. You know who's going to go into the lake of fire first? Put a little hellfire in here. You know who's gonna, cowards. Cowards are going to go into the lake of fire first. Using that as an excuse, I'm afraid to tell them. So but you're not afraid to tell other people and sin. Because it's gossip, slander, backbiting, whispering, right? So you're not afraid of that. You're afraid to tell the person. Cowards. Lake of fire for the cowards. But really, if we're going to understand boundaries, we've got to conquer fear, don't we? And honor and the law of respect is going to have to be in place. And the best way to respect is respect yourself and your own boundaries that you establish, whether people like them or not. Your yes is yes, your no is no. Otherwise, you enter into the evil realm of manipulation and control. Law number 5, the law of motivation. I did this with Jennifer, believe it or not. But Jennifer had a pretty rough relationships in her life up until we met. And we must be free to say no before we can wholeheartedly say yes to anything. Because on the one hand, I'm telling you, let your yes be yes and your no be no. But on the other hand, you're not free to say yes you're not really free to say no with the right motivation until you can wholeheartedly say yes. The source determines the force that determines the course. We preached on that before. I'm not going to get into that. But the source determines the force. People often fear that other people won't respect the boundaries that we set with them. But I can't live in fear. God didn't give me a spirit of fear, and I'm not taking it in. So you're not supposed to fear. If it's a godly, righteous boundary, you basically establish it whether people like it or not. It's not about being a people pleaser. Some people are afraid that if they tell people no or be specific about their needs, or other people will be disappointed, they'll be angry, or they'll be hurt. Let the pieces fall where they will. Because you need to be an expression. This is why I say this is part two, because last week, and if you haven't heard last week, you need to go back over it in light of this message, because it sets the foundation for this message. You cannot be a spiritual expression if you're not free to express yourself with integrity and dignity. If you're just expressing yourself to win friends and influence people, you're missing the mark, which is sin. But the fear of abandonment, if I have a boundary, the fear of not being loved, the fear of the other person's anger if I establish a boundary. If I establish a boundary and then I have this fear of being isolated, fear of losing the good me inside. I've dealt with this even with preachers. They're afraid of losing that selfish me. Some of them were raised in families where anything you wanted for yourself that was healthy, they told you you're being selfish. You ever heard that? All right? And some people are so afraid to establish a boundary because they think they're being selfish. All right? All of those are fear-based and guilt-based. And fear and guilt needs to be taken to the cross. God didn't give it to you. You shouldn't be living by it. That should not be in the law of motivation, a proper motivation. Many people do kind things out of guilt. Or somebody gives them something and they feel guilty, they automatically go into payback. I have to give back. That's unhealthy. As a matter of fact, there's people that will use that. When I say no to somebody, I feel bad. But if you receive stuff with that guilt message, you feel obligated to give back, and that's not healthy. The other person becomes a symbolic parent, and I need their approval. You need God's approval. And if they're really a parent, a spiritual parent, they will teach you how to get the approval directly from God righteously. Here's one that I see that people call ministry. Over-identification with other people's loss. Somebody's hurting and you go, oh, and you hug them. In reality, it's not the love of God, and it feels kind of creepy in the spirit, but most people don't even pay any attention to it. That person over there is just identifying with what they haven't resolved in their own life, and you're just triggering their own pain. They're not ministering to you. They're sympathizing with you because they've never dealt with that loss and that sense of emptiness in their own life. So they're attracted to you. Don't confuse that with ministry. They don't have nothing to give. They haven't dealt with it in their own life. If you haven't dealt with it in your own life, you don't have nothing to give except sympathy, pat on the back. A lot of good that's going to do. There's no anointing on it. All right. The law of evaluation, law number 6. We need to evaluate Let me cover something under there about the false motive. No, I'll get to that. Anyway, we need to evaluate that when we set boundaries, that it's both good for you and the other person. Sometimes that's a hard concept, but you need to say, you know what? I've got to evaluate. When I'm doing this, I'm not punishing somebody. I'm doing this for both of our good. Because though it may be difficult, it leads to honesty, a relief from the guilt. Why? Because you're expressing your integrity. You're expressing who you really are and your value system. This is my value. You don't have to like my value system, but this is it. I'm at least living with me, and I know that I'm an expression. And that expression is honest, and it's better communication of who you are and what you need. Though it might be difficult in setting these boundaries, it requires confrontation and hurt feelings. And everyone that I've ever seen in leadership that were quality leaders to me hated confrontation, but they all would do it. You can't not do it. But at the same time, if you like it, you've got another problem. I mean, if you just like it, all right? Because even though it's difficult, what you're doing for the person by establishing boundaries, it's anger and bitterness are less likely to set in because we're not being open about our needs or our limitations. You're finally declaring who you are. All right, I got to move on quickly here. Law number 7, the law of proactivity. All right, for every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. If someone has spent years being passive and compliant, they suddenly explode out of nowhere. Pay attention to this one. Passive and compliant. In other words, someone thought for them, taught them, this is how you behave, this is how you think, and this is how you feel. Well, they've been so compliant for so long, at times they don't know how they think, they don't know what they feel. They've been told by people who literally tried to live their life for them. Dads sometimes wanted to be a sports player, never made it, and they're going to force it down the kid's throat, whether he's interested or not. They're trying to live their life through them. Now, what happens with that is they're not respecting that child's boundary, and what's going to happen eventually is that there will be passive compliance until there is a sudden explosion. Now, I want you to listen to this part real carefully. That can be a part, no, we're not encouraging sudden explosions, But if they've never had a voice and never been allowed, they've been so beat down and compliant that they've never expressed themselves, this could be the beginning of freedom. And I'm not condoning sinful behavior. I'm simply saying that once they get brave enough to express themselves, but it's got to go beyond that. Do you agree? When Jennifer and I married, she was in such a way to where she was so verbally abused that she had a what we call a UGB, an ungodly belief. All right? She had a lie that is better not to talk. Talking only makes it worse. Am I right, Jennifer? Talking only makes it worse. But that's not a relationship because you never get to express yourself. And that compliancy only suppressed all of that until you want to explode. And you will implode, explode, whatever you do. You'll either be depressed, worn out, bummed out, or you're going to explode and start shooting people or something, you know? Literally. But what I did with Jennifer when I saw that 4 days later, she very timidly would say, well, this is Thursday, you know, and last Sunday, that bothered me when you said da, da, da. I'm going, this is Thursday, and you're reminding me of something I did Sunday, and I don't even know what it was. I said, Jennifer, this is not a relationship if you just stuff it. If you just suppress it, that's not a relationship. You have to express it. I taught her. God is my witness, didn't I, Jennifer? What did I do? I taught her how to talk back to me. I even picked the words. I'm going, this is crucifying my flesh unbelievably. But I taught her how to talk back to me. And I'm going, what am I doing? Oh, Jesus, I hope I'm doing the right thing here. But you know what it did? It enhanced the relationship. Because it was like I really heard where she was coming from. And most of it was not intentional. Most of it was things that I talk out loud, I think out loud. God forbid, people, I just walk around and think out loud verbally. They're bound to say something really, really dumb often. So I said these dumb things, and I didn't even realize. I'm thinking it through. I'm basically counseling myself when I talk out loud sometimes. It's not pretty all the time. And I taught her to talk back, and I'm going, that was part of but it can't end there. You don't just teach people to mouth off, right? That's not godly. But she, from being compliant to finding that I can express myself and the axe doesn't come down. That's the key. And again, my mother taught us at the table, we'd get in trouble, but she encouraged us to express ourselves. I'd express myself and I'd get a beating. I'd express myself, I'd get a beating. I'd express myself, I'd get a beating. But at least I knew I could express myself, but I also knew some things don't have to be said. This was not an overnight revelation. This took time. Some things are better off unsaid. There's a time to speak and a time to remain silent. But encouraged expressing myself. If you're going to have a relationship, I'll tell you one thing. My mom and dad knew where we were at out of that expression. Good or bad, they knew where we were at and could adjust accordingly. It's usually me that got adjusted. But accordingly. All right. I did this with another person that lived with us for 3 years too, didn't I? And now, she has a problem. Won't mention any names, but Vicky, you can't tell somebody or never tell somebody and it's like a secret, because then it's an unhealthy relationship and they will violate that boundary again and again because you haven't established it. If you don't speak up, we don't even know what your value system is. We don't know what your boundaries are. Don't think that people are just going to know. Husbands, tell your wives you love them. Wives, tell your husbands you love them. Don't think they should just know. I told them once, a long time ago. Why don't they just know? That's not a relationship, all right? So that's the law of proactivity. And that is that reaction phase is helpful, but it can't stop there. That reaction phase has to be turned into godly communication and respect, mutual respect. So the way we resolved it was once she began talking, I would say, okay, Jennifer, now I'm going to pray you through that. And I'd say something. She'd say, okay, Dennis, now I'm going to pray you through that. Shepherd, sheep, sheep, shepherd. And that really worked because that cultivated mutual respect. But without expression, I'd have never known. I'd have never known. All right. Law number 8. The law of envy. Now, I changed all of these to suit me. But we'll never get what we want if we focus outside of our boundaries onto what other people have. It is that simple. Quit comparing yourself amongst yourselves. There's no wisdom in it. But here's, we preached on this some weeks back. To sum that up, of wanting something outside of your boundary, the 5 deadly C's. Don't covet. Don't compare. Don't compete. Don't conceal. And don't complain. All of those attitudes come out of looking outside of God's provision for you and what somebody else has and what you don't have. Envy focuses on whether others have or accomplished, or in other words, outside of our boundaries. Law number 9. We need to take the initiative in establishing boundaries. We can't be passive. God gave us the ability to take initiative, and for us, it's to yield our will. The law of activity, that we can't not do anything. We need to fulfill our responsibility. But as we yield our will to His will, God works. And He wills and He performs according to His good pleasure. All right? And basically, not being passive, we taught our people to basically just drop down and blast. If in doubt, release love to them even while they're being creepy and demonic. What will happen is it may not change them, but it'll keep the poison from going in you, because when you're blasting, it's like a garden hose. You don't worry about dirt going up the nozzle, because greater is He that's in us than he that's in the world. So you release love to someone who's acting ungodly, and you're not going to be corrupted by their stuff. It won't go in. Number 10, the law of exposure. That law basically says we need to communicate our boundaries to each other. We said this before, you can't guess, second guess. When you communicate these boundaries, they need to be made visible to other people and communicated to them. Because basically, fear keeps people to have secret boundaries that nobody knows the rules. If boundaries are unexpressed, relationship will suffer. Nothing good ever comes from a lack of boundaries. If they're not exposed directly, they'll be communicated indirectly. Passive-aggressive or manipulation. You know what passive-aggressive is? We had a builder once that was like that. Is if you pushed him, he will drag his feet and say, it'll be a long time before you ever get that done, and I'm going to smile at you, but I ain't going to do it. All right? That's when boundaries aren't clear and you push somebody, they can respond that way. When in reality, they could have said, I want to get this done as soon as you can. But that's probably, in a perfect world, it would be done on your timetable, but it's not a perfect world. It's probably going to take an extra week. Express yourself out of integrity and reality instead of going, I'll show you. You have a different boundary, but you're not expressing it. And that person is supposed to guess that you're dragging your feet because you pushed them, or that you had a time element. All right. I want to get to the conclusion. This is a long one, isn't it? This is part 2 to last week, right? Go like this, all right? Because we're going to still have testimonies. Here's the conclusion. All of the things that we talked about this morning literally took things you should have learned at age 4, 5, and 6 and extrapolated it toward mature adult words. Really. Listen to this. This is a list that we had some years ago. Everything that I learned in kindergarten. Share everything. Did you learn that in kindergarten? To share. Play fair. These are deep, deep concepts. Don't hit people. Huh? Put things back where you found them. Wow, what an eye-opener. Clean up your own mess. Come on. We don't have a janitor here. If you've got coffee cups, throw it in the trash before you leave. Should have learned that in kindergarten.
Huh? Empty coffee cups.
Empty coffee cups. Yeah. Garbage gets really heavy when there are full coffee cups in the trash can. Empty coffee cup in the sink and then throw the cup. Put things back where you found them. Clean up your own mess. Don't take things that aren't yours. Kindergarten. Say you're sorry when you hurt somebody. This is too complicated. Wash your hands before you eat. Flush. Warm cookies and cold milk are good for you. Live a balanced life. Learn some, think some, draw and paint, sing and dance and play. Huh? And work every day some. Take a nap every afternoon. I don't know if that gets you in trouble or not. But that's good advice. Take a nap every noon. And when you go out in the world, watch out for traffic. Hold hands and stick together. Be aware of wonder. Remember the little seed in the styrofoam cup. The roots go down and the plant goes up and nobody really knows how or why. But we are all like that. Goldfish and hamsters and white mice and even the little seed in the styrofoam cup, they all die and so do we. And then remember the Dick and Jane books and the first word you learned, the biggest word of all. Look! Everything you know is in there somewhere. The golden rule, love, basic sanitation, ecology, politics, equality, and just sane living. All of those are in those things that we could have learned in kindergarten. The golden rule, all of it. And if you take any one of those things and extrapolate it out to home, government, business, it still works. And so basically, I just believe that what God is going to do in the days ahead is he's going to get us to honor and move in integrity by letting our yes be yes and our no be no, and expressing our boundaries, and not for fear of man having no boundaries, or worse, setting into someone else's boundary. They need to know. And they may not like it. You have to do it as unto God, not as unto people pleasing, because therein lies a lot of false love. When in reality, in the long run, you're doing them harm. You're not loving them. In the long run, you're giving a value system that is confusing to them. And just like Jennifer, I'll tell you what, that was a perfect scenario for someone who didn't want to say what was bothering her. But fortunately, I could feel her spirit, and I'd say, what's wrong? And she'd say, well, then you have something to pray through. Now, she goes, can I tell you something? Oh, no, here it comes. She never did it before, though. She does it a little more sneaky, though. She goes like this. She goes, honey, I was thinking. That's a good start right there, too. I was thinking, because I know something's going to come after that. It's probably going to cause me to make an adjustment. There's probably a boundary that's going to be expressed. But bottom line, let's pray this as a prayer. We had this pinned up in the bulletin board. If you've got a problem with me, come to me privately. If I have a problem with you, I will come to you privately. If someone has a problem with me and comes to you, send them to me. I'll do the same for you. This is not rocket science, but this is scriptural. If you have aught against someone, go to that person and them alone. If someone will consistently not come to me and say, well, I'm afraid to talk to him, but I can talk to everybody else, then say, let's go see him together. I'll do the same for you. Wouldn't this be a good relationship agreement? Be careful how you interpret me. On matters that are unclear, do not feel pressure to interpret my feelings or thoughts. It's easy to misinterpret intentions. I'll be careful on how I interpret you. What did one pastor said? That whatever people don't know, eventually, if they never find out, they fill it in with their own guess. Better to have good communication then, isn't it? Because you'll fill it in with something. It won't remain empty forever. You'll put an opinion in there. So, Father, we just pray right now that there's going to be a new level of respect and relationship by the Spirit of God. Teach us boundaries properly. Teach us how to respond. Teach us how to express our boundaries and establish them more clearly that others might know. And cause the motive in the boundaries to be that of respect and also for the long term, not for the short term, but for the long-term relationship. I don't want to be an opportunist. I don't want to be someone that just uses people for my own ends. I don't want to use Madison Avenue techniques in my interpersonal relationships with people. I want being trumping doing. And I want the value to be on their personhood, not on what they can do for me. So Father, right now in the name of Jesus, we just say in the days ahead, teach us to honor and respect one another. Teach us to clarify boundaries. Teach us to respect boundaries. There's boundaries that need to be expanded in the love of God and the peace of God, that we would be peacemakers who know how to war righteously. There are boundaries that need to be expanded, boundaries that need to be broken, and boundaries that need to be sustained. Teach us, Holy Spirit, and grant us the wisdom in the days ahead. In Jesus' name, amen.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.